Welcome to Richfield High School on a cold, snowy evening, but a heated Classic Suburban battle is about to take place as the Richfield Spartans host the Simley Spartans in a battle for first place. Richfield coming in at 15-3, 7-1 in the conference. Simley at 16-4, also 7-1 in conference play. Hello, everyone. I'm Mike Peden here with Alex Nagel. Once again, thank you for joining us. And one of these schools is going to end their winning streak, and one will extend it tonight. Simley has won their last 12 games. Richfield has won their last 10. How do you think it's going to play out?
Well, you're right, Mike. You know, this is one of those situations where the old saying, something's got to give, comes into play. When you look at this a little bit closely, you would have to, I suppose, give a slight edge to Richfield being on their home court. But I wouldn't underestimate the Simley team, Mike. You know, this is a team that has been through a lot of battles here lately. You know, they've had four losses, two of them in the last 5 seconds. So they're battle-tested. They know what it takes to stay close in these tough kind of games. So, you know, well, this is a young team, too, when you talk about Simley. But I think they've come a long way since the beginning of the season. So it'll be interesting to see how things develop as the game progresses.
And in all of Simley's losses, none have been more than 6 points. And that also included an overtime loss to Tartan. Yep. But their winning streak began when they beat this Richfield team at their facility back in December. Richfield was playing their final game of a 3-game stretch. What do you think it's going to be different from that first matchup? How do you think Richfield adjusts after losing 51-49?
Well, you know, I think, you know, when you lose a tough one, you know, and you, especially in a situation where both teams are fairly familiar with one another, it's easy to tweak the game plan. It's easier. You can look, go back and look at the game film and see where things need to be tweaked. And I think Richfield is obviously going to be looking at, you know, getting the ball to Jessica January as much as possible. We'll let her do what she does best, score and drive and penetrate. And I think that's going to be one of the big factors tonight for Richfield.
Richfield has been getting more support, though, in the last few games. And, of course, Simley has a talented group. So let's delve into this a little further with our keys to the game. For the home Richfield Spartans, they want to play better transition defense in the first meeting against Simley. They want to improve their communication as well, and they've stepped up on that. And obviously, they've won the last 10 games, so something had to step up. And they want to continue their cleanup work on offense, just being more efficient, getting more points out of it, and really spreading the ball around, because January is still scoring a lot, but she's getting a little more help.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that. You know, they say that it's actually not a good thing when January starts scoring 30-plus points. They feel like they have to have better scoring distribution, and that may be a key. Sierra Ford Washington, I think, definitely fits into that picture, you know, from a scoring standpoint anyway.
And speaking of keys, here are Simley's. They'll want to handle Richfield's pressure. Richfield likes to run the ball. They're a very quick, athletic group. They'll want to take advantage of the size inside. They have a much bigger interior offense than Richfield does. Richfield's tallest player, Leah Barnes, and Simley led by a couple of six foot plus yep. folks in Abby Kain and Kylie Brown, and they want to draw them off the traps.
Well, I think Abby Kain is obviously going to be a big, you know, focus point for Simley here tonight. You know, she's got to use the height advantage that she has inside and score often and early.
Starting lineups are coming up in a moment. You're watching high school girls basketball on TSB Television. Stick around.
Rise and bright stars through the perilous fight.
How about that? A live rendition of the anthem. Usually they have to play some stock music.
Well, I tell you what, that's a great way to get this great evening underway here, Mike. It may be cold and snowy outside, but it's hot in here.
And let's get underway with the starting lineups. First, for the visiting Simley Spartans, it's number one, Abby Kine, 6'1", freshman forward. Number three, Alexis Boyd Lockett, 5'7", senior guard. Number 15, Maya DeLau, 5'7", junior guard. Number 23, Asia Lockett, 5'8", guard, eighth grader. And number 33, Kylie Brown, 6'3", junior wing, listed as a guard, but plays more of the four. Richfield will start. Number 14, Jessica January, 5'7", senior guard. We've mentioned her name a few times. Kaylee Adams, number 22, 5'10", sophomore forward. Number 30, Sierra Ford Washington, 5'6", senior guard. Number 40, Kyla Adams, 5'10", freshman forward. And number 50, Dominique Hammonds, the 5'4", junior guard. Haley Lindblom will not start tonight because she just came back from a trip from Washington, D.C. And we'll talk more about that as the game goes on. But let's take a quick look at the Classic Suburban standings. Suburban East, well, where am I kidding? As we mentioned, both teams at 7-1, and it's feasible that whoever wins this game could take that conference title. I know the state championship is what all the teams go for, but in terms of some bragging rights, this game could decide where that goes.
Yeah, that's what makes this so fun about this night. You know, not only with conference implications, but with seeding implications as well, Mike. You know, that's what makes covering something like this so incredibly fun and exciting.
And rankings, another storyline. Simley looking to move up from their 10th spot. Richfield at number 3. Simley started in the top 10, dropped out when they went to 4-4, but they've won their last 12 games. And then Richfield, they went through a bit of struggles too, got blown up by Kennedy the last time we were here, and have won the last 10.
You know, any time when you're playing Richfield, especially on their home court, Mike, it's so critically important to take care of the basketball. You've got to limit your turnovers. You have to be aware where Jessica January is at all times because she's such a great defender. In addition to being a great scorer, you have to know where she is.
The two schools are in different sections, so this could be a state tournament preview as well. Simley in Section 4, and right now the favorite to be taking that section. Hill Murray having a bit of a down year, Highland Park falling apart. Richfield in Section 6, they've got to get through Chaska most likely, and Benilde St. Margaret's is tough as well. Simley with the first possession, they're wearing the white jerseys. Richfield wearing their familiar maroon home uniforms.
Just what I'm talking about right there, Mike.
Jessica January with the steal. Goodbye. She averages 20 points a game. That, oddly enough, that doesn't even, not even close to the lead in the Classic Suburban Conference. That belongs to Tia Elbert. But the big difference, Elbert, Tartan's lone bastion of offense, Richfield having several, and they've really developed in the last few games.
Right away, we see Richfield putting on some backcourt pressure here, Mike.
Maya DeLau finding Asia Lockett, the eighth grader. Simley, no stranger to starting young players on varsity. Kind started on this team a year ago as an eighth grader. Deflected off January, Simley takes possession. As we mentioned, Richfield lost to Simley in the first meeting of the year. Richfield was playing their third game in 3 days straight. Richfield had on the front end of a back-to-back series, they go over to their crosstown rival Holy Angels tomorrow in a boys-girls doubleheader. Here's Asia Lockett going over to DeLau, finding Kain. Traveling violation. Richfield's going to need to do that frequently to get an advantage inside because Kain is taller than everybody else on the floor.
Yep. Simley needs to get themselves settled down here on offense, play some solid D.
I shouldn't say taller than everybody else. Leah Barnes is on the Richfield roster, but not in the starting lineup as they work to get her back in shape. Here's Kaylee Adams. No travel call. Rebound DeLau. Finding Lockett. Lines up the three. Off the heel. Rebound. Dead ball rebound to Richfield. And how about this? I haven't seen a crowd this big at some time in a Richfield game, but everybody kind of understanding the implications behind this game. Here's Sierra Ford Washington. Looking for Adams, but Adams went a little too far, and here's a steal. It's Alexis Boyd Lockett, and she gets the fast break layup for the Simley Spartans.
Nice move there by Alexis Boyd Lockett.
Jessica January, baseline drive, rejected by Kylie Brown. Brown at 6'3", January 5'7", so Brown going to have a few inches. And I spoke with Tim Peper, the Simley head coach, and he said, especially when they try to trap Brown, compared to other guards, she can see over everybody. And here is Haley Lindblom coming in from Richfield.
You know, in that last situation there where we saw Jessica January getting blocked inside, she's really going to have to pick her spots, Mike, when she decides to drive into the paint.
January is a smart player, though, so I don't think Scott Statham or anybody else is too concerned about her performance. De Lau with a mid-range switch.
Nice recognition there by Kylie Brown finding the open person on the wing.
Now we have a reach-in foul called against Simley. 4-2 in the opening minutes of the first half. Ford Washington to inbound. Finds January. Now she tries the mid-range, that's off the mark. Adams with the rebound, and a clean block from Kain.
Not unusual to see Jessica January to get off to a slightly slow start from a scoring standpoint, Mike.
Kain averaging 2.5 blocks per game, so she is no stranger to rejections. But really developing as a post inside for Simley. Asia Lockett handling the ball, going up against Lindblom. Again, Lindblom missed Richfield's earlier game this week. It was a blowout win over St. Paul Johnson, so she wasn't necessarily needed, but again, took a trip to Washington, D.C., part of a school program actually called Close Up. One of the sponsors is General Mills, and her grandmother happened to work there, so that set the stage. January will be called for the reach-in foul. Lindblom with the steal. She brings a defensive tenacity that few other players on Richfield's roster can match. Adams missing her target on the bounce pass, and De Lau with a steal. Finds Lockett for three. Off the heel again. Kylie Brown using her 6'3" frame to scoop the rebound. Jump ball, possession arrow favors Richfield.
Tell you, this is interesting to watch, Mike. Definitely what you would call a contrast of styles here that we're seeing already.
Kylie Brown averaging a double-double for the Spartans, as is Abby Kain. In fact, Kain get this. Or Brown, I should say, 12.4 points, 12.8 rebounds a game. Not too often you get a player with more rebounds than points. Ford Washington losing the handle and a Richfield turnover.
A great defense that time by Alexis Boyd Lockett getting in there, causing problems.
And again, if you haven't heard of Simley too often, they haven't made much noise until the last couple of years. They had a 22-win season a year ago. Here's Kaylee Adams with the steal. Breakaway, yes! And Kaylee Adams has really stepped up in the last few games for Richfield. She's close to 10 points a game. But as we mentioned, Simley lost to Highland Park. That team was formidable a year ago. This year they've fallen apart. Simley throws it away.
Well, some obvious miscommunication there.
And Simley will call timeout with 13:45 remaining in the first half. So, 30-second timeout. Alex, your observation so far?
Well, it's each team right now, Mike, is trying to establish their style and see what will work. Right now, score tied at 4-4. You know, it's really hard to give an edge to either side right now. But the one thing I think, again, that I think you have to be concerned about, from a Simley standpoint anyway, is that if Richfield gets tends to get most of their points and transitions off of steals, it means that Simley's not taking good enough care of the basketball. And that was the one key that I thought was critical from Simley from the get-go.
We resume play, 13 minutes and 40 seconds left in the first half. Lindblom is intercepted by Alexis Boyd Lockett. Goodbye.
Talk about turning the tables there.
You'd expect a lot of feeling each other out here between two top 10 teams. Foul before the shot. Richfield dominated this series in previous years, although Simley has won the last two games. And that's what helped Simley get themselves noticed last year, was taking down a stronger Hill Murray team. They still had Tessasichi at the time, and of course Richfield, who finished second in the Class 3A state tournament. But I'll say this, Simley section, Section 4-3A, is no longer an automatic berth, effectively, for Hill Murray. We could see Simley making some noise. We've got a foul, over the back foul called, and I believe it will be taken to Kyla Adams. No, it's on Kaylee Adams, but Simley gets the ball regardless. New player in for Simley, it's number 21, and that player is Jen Willard. And neither team can decide who wants the ball right now. Oh my goodness, what a pass from January to Lindblom. The long skip, Simley didn't see it coming, Lindblom scores.
Great move by Lindblom there.
Lindblom doesn't score a lot for Richfield, but brings a quickness that really helps them out. Kain missing the runner. Rebound, Kyla Adams. Ford Washington brings it up. Lindblom back to Ford Washington. Here's January. And as we mentioned in the open, January at the start of the season said, I do not want to score 35 points a game. I want to get everyone else involved. I do not want to carry the load. Here's January with a mid-range swish. Oddly enough, with Tony Gear speculated that part of it was DePaul's request, but even at this level, I think you're better off getting everyone else involved, because if you have a rough night, other players can step up. January wasn't even the leading scorer in win over Johnson earlier this week.
Yep.
For three, bullseye. Right now, January outscoring the Simley team. It's still early, but she has 7 points.
Well, when January starts opening up from the perimeter, starts getting hot, that opens up the opportunities for the other scorers, Mike.
Well, she is no stranger. She knows how to score. Lockett cannot get the response, but an offensive rebound by Brown. Here's Willard. Can't line up the counter either. Adams with the rebound. January crossed the 2,000-point milestone last year in the state tournament final. Adams for three. That goes in. No, they call it a two, but Kyla Adams showing a little perimeter range. Alexis Boyd Lockett nearly lost it. She does lose it. Adams picks it up. One-on-one. Can't beat Lockett. Ford Washington draws the foul.
I would almost expect Simley head coach Tim Peper to call a timeout here, Mike, and get his squad calmed down, settle down, make some adjustments here. See if he does so after the free throws.
If this Richfield run continues, he might. The Richfield Spartans have scored the last 9 points. Ford Washington just averaging under 10 points a game, but has become a reliable second option in Richfield's offense, especially in those in the 10-game winning streak. And for those of you thinking Richfield had it easy, a couple of those wins included Wayzata and Edina, two Lake Conference perennials.
Yep.
Ford Washington makes both free throws to get on the board. Richfield has now scored the last 11 points. De Lau to Kine. Trying to find Lockett. January disrupts the pass and forces another turnover.
And that turnover bugaboo right now is really starting to bite Simley hard, Mike.
This is a much different Richfield team than the one that met Simley back in December. And an illegal screen of sorts. It's called against Kaylee Adams. That's going to be her second. That may force Scott Staten to go to the bench. And he will. He's going to send her twin sister, Kyla, to replace Kaylee. 10:26 remaining in the first half. And Richfield up 15-6. Here's Kain. She draws the push foul. Draws the push foul against Kyla Adams, and you notice how close the Richfield defenders are playing Kain.
Well, down nine here, it's going to be important for Simley, I think, to get the ball inside to Kain to see what she can do, use that height advantage that they have right now.
Katie Atkins in the game for the Simley Spartans. Lockett for three. Still can't find it. But a high recoil, offensive rebound goes right back to her. Kyle Adams with the steal. Finds January down court. January with a fast break layup.
Boy, they make it look easy, don't they?
The run is now 13-0. January with 9 points. Reach in foul on Leah Barnes, making her first visit on the bench for the Richfield Spartans. And let's take a look at some of the notes that we got. With this Richfield start, it's been very impressive. Getting through that rough stretch, they said, helped. Another foul on Richfield. And I believe that's their last to give. Scott Staten mentioned, though, it is their last, so Richfield out of fouls to give now. After the Kennedy loss, they said they got away from playing their brand of basketball. They got so flustered. Kain can't get the kiss off the glass. Brown with the offensive rebound, dishes to Kain, and Kain cleans it up for her first field goal.
Right there, that's what Simley wants to do, Mike. Breaks the run.
No basket, offensive rebound to Ford Washington. De Lau picks it up just before it goes out of bounds and finds Atkins. She faces a trap. Can't escape. Kyle Adams losing the handle, and she'll feed to January to settle things down. ...17-8 in favor of Richfield. Lindblom over to Ford Washington. And Scott Staten will call timeout with 8:44 remaining, and not a bad time for one. So as Richfield takes a timeout, let's take a look at this capsule for Simley a little bit.
Looking a little bit at Maya DeLeo of Simley. She wants to stay for college plans anyway. She wants to stay fairly close to home and go to something small. I would interpret that to be possibly a Mayak
school. Mr. Mayak over here, ladies and gentlemen. A lot of multi-sport athletes from Simley. De Lau is one of them, and she said the strange thing about herself is she's Mexican. I've heard of stranger, but I'm sure everyone's involved, and so De Lau, we mentioned a junior, a lot of youth on this team, and so Simley's going to have a lot of camaraderie coming in. And speaking of youth, Asia Lockett, the eighth grader, already has plans, wants to go to a four-year university, D1 or D2, so she's not too picky yet. But she also is a huge One Direction and Justin Bieber fan, as I would expect. I would expect someone of her age bracket to be a fan of.
Yeah.
Well, one thing's for sure, she likes her four music artists. You know, Justin Bieber's from Canada, and One Direction is an Irish group.
That's all right, nothing wrong with that.
No love for the American boy bands or boy groups. Richfield with possession, 17-8 is our score. Again, Richfield using a 13-0 run to pull out to a 9-point advantage. January in trouble, finds Ward Washington. And again, we see Richfield being patient. They can push the ball, but they will back off too. January drawing the foul. Free throw's coming. Fouls on Kine, her second.
What a strong drive by Jessica January.
Well, she's learned a thing or two over the years. She's played on the varsity roster since eighth grade.
Well, it just right there gives you a great example of her explosiveness, Mike.
And she's also in the top of her class in GPA. In fact, I spoke with Scott Statham yesterday, and he said, outside of science fiction trivia, Star Trek and Star Wars, Jessica January would have the edge. She knows a lot of information that surprised her head coach. She makes both free throws. She's up to 11. And we usually don't see this out of January. She's usually more calm in the first half and steps up in the second, but sensing, oh, nice try by Lindblom, but she ran out of bounds. Once again, though, very and can anticipate passes.
Well, yeah, and you know, as aggressive as Richfield is, you know, Simley's going to have to be very careful of those passing lanes, Mike. It's almost threading the needle almost with their passes. They have to be very careful, very precise.
Here's Kylie Brown, who has yet to score for Simley, and a traveling violation. Alexis Boyd Lockett
lifted up that foot just a little bit. That's all it took.
And another Simley turnover, 7:47 remaining in the first half. Richfield trying to hold on to their third place ranking. I'm not sure they can move up unless De La Salle or Fergus Falls drops one. Simley would like to move up. I'm still not convinced on Fergus Falls being number one because of the geography involved. They don't get to play the same caliber of opponents that De La Salle and Richfield do, but folks often get attached to that record. January pulls up again, off the heel. Dead ball rebound to Simley. To finish up that point, I think the bookies, prognosticators, they get so fixated on records, they see Fergus Falls is undefeated. Oh, they must be really good.
Yeah.
Well, who have they played? Strength of schedule, to me, is more indicative of how a team is doing than a record, per se.
Yep.
As you talked about before the mercy rule, you would get lopsided schedules so teams could, you know, rack up a lot of wins quickly. You don't get that as much now in the non-conference slate.
Yeah.
Boyd Lockett over to Kylie Brown. Asia Lockett now inside to number 32, and she loses the ball to Dominique Hammonds. Number 32 for Simley. We'll get a name for her in a moment. Here's Bobby Beaver, works her way around traffic, can't get the bounce. And let me take a look at your roster there. I need to see who number 32 is for Simley. Lockett, number 32 is Lexi Siriswate. Brown, swish, and she finally gets on the board.
Big basket there for Simley, gets the margin back within single digits here, Mike.
19-10. As Richfield, as much as they've dominated in this game, here's Lindblom with a baseline J. An 11-point lead is not that large. It looks that way, but Simley not out of this. At least not yet. Long way to go. But look at January swarming Boyd Lockett. Boyd Lockett left alone. Can't hit the three. Leah Barnes with the rebound. Barnes dealing with some injuries throughout the year. Bobby Beaver for Richfield in the game. January, top of the key, bullseye. January has already matched her jersey number, 14 points, and she's still outscoring Simley.
On the first day of February, no less.
I'm sure if she had a dollar for every time she heard that, she wouldn't even have to worry about school. She wouldn't need a scholarship to DePaul. But I'm sure she's happy to get one. Her sister finishing up her athletic career at South Dakota. And Simley with the response. That's Katie Atkins with a baseline J of her own.
Good ball movement that time.
Lindblom can't hit the three. Rebound, Atkins. And she's pulled from behind by Barnes, didn't sense it. Barnes throws it up and draws a foul. Barnes started the year on the starting lineup, got shifted to the reserve. Again, still growing into her body for her age, even though she's a sophomore, she has the body of a freshman.
Good touch at the free throw line by the sophomore. Abby Kain comes back in now for Simley.
Richfield has yet to miss from the free throw line. They've made all five attempts.
Jen Willard is in there as well now.
And I jinxed him. Boyd Lockett, double teamed, finds a way out of it. Asia Lockett jukes coverage, but still cannot hit the three-pointer.
I tell you, Richfield doing an excellent job of boxing out, Mike.
They are focused. No foul called. Richfield will keep possession. 4:29 remaining in the first half. And it, January and Ford Washington, offensive foul.
You got a moving screen there.
Looks that way. It's going to be tagged to Ford Washington, or no, Beaver, I should say. That's her first. Was going to say January and Ford Washington. Tentatively, they still have to make it official, but both have been selected to the All-Star team in the Coaches Association All-Star game for Class 3A. And that's one of the top honors you can get in the state. Of course, a couple of national all-stars, Nia Coffey at Hopkins and Rebecca Dahlman. Foul, Boyd Lockett will go to the line. Coffey and Dahlman selected to the McDonald's All-America game, and I think it's the first time in a long time, if not ever, where two Minnesotans are representing the field. Boyd Lockett, can't give you her free throw numbers because they don't have the attempts down there, but she does average 8.8 points per game. And she finally makes her first here. 8.8 points and 2.3 rebounds a game, 3.4 assists. Let's see if that gives Simley a calming force here. Boyd Lockett leading with 6 points. January dumps it off and a traveling violation. Kyla Adams stepped before she dribbled. It'll stay with Simley. No, January did get the
turnover. I thought maybe it was, we were looking at a reaching foul there, Mike.
Sometimes I wonder if the officials see us and they just try to juke us intentionally.
From our angle, it was kind of tough to tell.
And we can't see the baseline like we usually can because we have a big crowd in front of us. But I'll take the big crowd. Kain with the steal. Takes it herself, too strong, and had an option on the outlet. I wonder if she should have dumped it off there. January pulls up again. Short this time, Kime with the board.
Abby Kain, great defense on that last one, Mike. She's got to make sure she converts.
And of Simley's four losses, Brown dumping to Kine, too strong. Kine still has a little work there. She can use the dribble drive, but could have used a little more finesse there.
Tough break for the freshman there in those last two.
Well, she has a lot of time left.
Oh, yeah.
And this game and looking ahead, too. Hammonds. Three-pointer's too strong. And the rebound will stay with Richfield. Of Simley's four losses, Tim Peper mentioned it gave them some lessons that could not be simulated in practices. You know, created situations that they had to learn from on the fly. Ford Washington finding the open player, Leah Barnes with the layup.
Leah Barnes just came back into the game for Richfield, and she made good on that one.
Boyd Lockett drains the runner.
Great move by Alexis Boyd Lockett there. I tell you, she's been hounding out there on the perimeter so far tonight, Mike.
Tim Peper says Boyd Lockett can score when needed to. Ford Washington, too strong. Rebound, Brown. That's Boyd Lockett. De Lau not on the floor right now. There's Asia Lockett. Over to 21, Willard. Boyd Lockett doesn't like what she sees. They find Kain inside. And sooner or later, Kain will make you pay for giving her a hole inside, and we've got another timeout.
Nice job here by Simley hanging in there. They're still down 27-18, but back within nine. They've been hanging in there. They haven't hit that proverbial panic button as some other teams have. And, you know, we've got a good contest here, Mike, coming down to the home stretch of the first half.
Abby Kain, we mentioned a freshman, played on the varsity roster as an eighth grader, and not only that, she played on the volleyball and softball teams in eighth grade. Said likes to play because she gets to play against rival schools, having fun with teammates, volleyball and softball, as we mentioned. Would like to attend an academic college that excels in athletics. And she still has a lot of growing to do. And like we mentioned, 12.8 points, or I should say 16.1 points per game, 12.4 rebounds a game. And last year she averaged a double-double. So Kain, a bastion of consistency despite her youth.
Yeah. Yep.
You wouldn't expect that out of too many freshmen. You
know? No, no.
To average a double-double your first 2 years?
Yeah, that just shows you how much potential she really has.
Shoots over 60% from the floor, has struggled a little bit so far in this game, but she's not a volume shooter. And Pepper said she just continues to blow his mind. Nobody saw this coming. They knew she would play varsity, but Pepper said the fact that she can handle the stronger post players now is a huge asset, and that's why she is such a potent force now for the Simley Spartans. Takes a breather for now. January, dumping to Barnes. She works up against her coverage. That's Saraswate, traveling violation.
Well, there you saw January. You know, she could have driven inside, but, you know, like you were saying, right, she wants to get her teammates involved.
Well, she has 14 points, and again, does not want to make this a one-dimensional offense. January averaging about 8 assists per game, and in a win over South St. Paul earlier this season, had a double-double with 15 points, 14 assists. We've got a foul in Richfield, and they are in the penalty. One-on-one situation for Simley. That will send Saraswate to the line. Lexi Saraswate, not too active offensively, just 1.6 points per game, averages 1.4 rebounds. Beaver going back in for the Richfield Spartans. Simley located in Inver Grove Heights, a suburb in Ramsey County, not too far from St. Paul.
Oh, great hustle. Great hustle there by Alexis Boyd Lockett.
That gets her the O board. Saraswati dumps out and missing the three-pointer. Good look, though, from Willard. And another offensive rebound by Saraswati. She finds Asia Lockett, who floats it over the outstretched arm of Bobby Beaver.
Wow.
That's a flashy way to get your first field goal. January will be called for the charge.
And all of a sudden here, Mike, with that charge being called on Jessica January, the momentum and complexion of this game has changed dramatically.
Psychologically, if Simley can score on their next possession, it would be a huge boost. It's 27-20, but again, Richfield has been the dominant team throughout the first half. Richfield trying a little pressure. That's going to give Simley an opening, but January with the steal. Boyd Lockett lost the handle. January, 2-on-1, opts to drive herself and scores.
Uh-oh.
Steal by Barnes off the inbound. Barnes is fouled. Count it! Are you kidding? We talked about psychological swings. Well, Richfield getting a huge one in their direction. The foul is on Asia Lockett. You don't see that often in the span of 10 seconds.
Well, and you know, I think Alexis Boyd-Lockett was anticipating somebody to be there on that short little pass, and there was some obvious miscommunication there, and Richfield took advantage.
Barnes can't complete the three-point play, but still two big possessions, and another steal. January dumping to Barnes again. A clean block this time by Boyd-Lockett, but Richfield completely sniping Simley's passes. January directing traffic. Richfield will run out the clock here. Ford Washington getting a push, leaves her open for three, can't hit it. And a foul on Richfield with 4.4 seconds and Simley in the double bonus. So again, Richfield getting a huge boost there, but now Simley has a chance to score a couple more points here. And so Richfield can't put down the exclamation point, and Saraswati will have a chance to make this a single digit margin before halftime.
Okay, those last 25 seconds were a little bit disastrous for Simley. They at least avoid total meltdown with a chance here to get some points right before halftime.
How many times did you mention last week how important it was to make free throws? Alex and I covered the Humboldt-Washburn game last week. Saraswati missing both. Beaver with the rebound. Richfield still has time for a shot. Ford Washington on the line. Will it count? Yes!
How about that?
Ford Washington with their first field goal beats the buzzer. And she stepped on the line. Could have had a three, but I don't think Richfield cares right now. They're up 33-20, scoring 6 points in the last 30 seconds. And when it looked like Simley had a chance to work the way back in there psychologically, Richfield acting like the bully pulpit.
Yeah, you know, it's just that aggressiveness on defense, you know, being able to get steals and being able to convert on them for quick points. That's been the difference so far in this contest, Mike.
Well, we're going to pause for a few moments while I catch my breath and get my voice back. Richfield leading 33-20 in this Classic Suburban Showdown. You're watching high school girls basketball on TSB Television. To high school girls basketball on TSB Television as we continue coverage of our Classic Suburban Showdown between Richfield and Simley, an epic battle of Spartans. That's their nickname. Richfield leading 33-20, getting a huge boost in the final 30 seconds thanks to a lot of steals and that buzzer beater from Ford Washington.
Well, and again, Mike, it all comes down, from a Simley standpoint anyway, of taking care of the basketball. You know, we know how aggressive Richfield is with their defense, particularly in the backcourt, putting on pressure, and that's how they were able to get a bulk of their points, you know, off of turnovers. Now, you're down 33-20 here going into the beginning of the second half. Not that big of a deficit, but you're going to have to make some adjustments here. And number one, primary, is taking care of the basketball. You know, once they get into that half-court offense, you know, getting Kain and Brown involved, if they can feed the ball into them and let them score, use their height, that's going to be a huge boost here for the Simley team.
Let's take a look at the first half stats. Richfield led by Jessica January with 16 points. Leah Barnes is next with 5. Lindblom and Ford Washington both have 4. But again, January taking the initiative there in the first half. Certainly does not want to do that all the time. Simley was led by Alexis Boyd-Lockett with 8 points and Abby Kine at 4. Everyone else could not get more than 2. But again, Richfield's defense was just so stingy on Simley. It was difficult for Simley to find many looks.
Yeah. Well, you know, as I pointed out in that first half, I'll tell you, Alexis Boyd-Lockett was just getting hounded out there on the perimeter.
And how do you think Simley bounces back? Because again, they gave up three baskets in the final 30 seconds, yeah. losing the ball a couple of times. I can't imagine they're too rattled because they've been through this before. They went through an overtime loss to Tartan and yeah. a few other close ones. What do you think Tim Peper told his group?
Ooh.
Well, certainly not that. Lindblom forcing the steal. January finding Kaylee Adams. Count it.
And not how you want to start out this second half if you're Simley.
No first half drop off for Richfield. Scott Staten really likes how the Adams sisters have been contributing. He believes that they stayed at Kennedy, they would not be playing the minutes they are right now. And one thing both sisters have in common, they can use their bodies to their advantage even yep. if they're undersized in the post. Adams completes a three-point play. Almost losing the ball. Gets control. Brown to Kain. That's a combination they want to hook up, but Kain just not finding it from short range.
Richfield being patient here.
Ford Washington. Or that was January, I should say. Missed the baseline, Jay. Here is De Lau. Didn't see much action in the first. Bounces it over to Brown. And Brown gets the bucket. And a carrying violation on Richfield. Now it's the Richfield's turn to make those backcourt miscues.
That's one thing Richfield has to be careful of. Not getting complacent. You know, they've got to watch those silly mistakes.
We talked about this may have seeding implications should these two reach state. Simley figures to be the favorite in their section, Section 6, although Hill Murray can still pull out a surprise or two.
Yeah.
De Lau with the right wing three.
Well, Alexis Boyd Lockett showing her range. If she can get hot in the second half.
That was Boyd Lockett, you're right. I thought it was De Lau, but.
There's a steal.
There's Alexis Boyd Lockett. Simley, they're not going to be too rattled from the end of that first half. Not with that group. Brown to Kain. Kain still not finding it.
Struggling from that short range.
60%, but struggling tonight. Three-pointer for Kaylee Adams. She's up to 8. De Lau bounced over to Kain, but didn't see defenders coming in January with the strip. Adams again. Can't hit it this time, but her twin sister gets the O-board. January out to Adams. Another offensive rebound. This time Adams with a little pump fake. She can't hit the mid-range, Jay, though. And an over-the-back foul on Richfield. Not a great way to end that possession, but.
That last pass down there by DeLau, those are the kind of things that Simley has to avoid. You have to pass with a purpose. You can't throw lazy passes or lazy bounce passes. Those are the kind of balls that Richfield is going to jump on and convert off of, Mike.
Simley, their rise over the last few years
There's
has
another one.
In part. Well, Haley Lindblom with the steal, bouncing over to Ford Washington, got it. So the pair of best friends hooking up on that play for Richfield. And another Richfield
yep.
steal of sorts, and Pepper's gonna call timeout. Richfield up 41-25. You get the feeling of a state tournament atmosphere right here.
No, you sure do. And this is, you know, Simley right now is getting an idea of what it's like to play in a very hostile environment, you know, here at Richfield. And they're not taking good care of the basketball. You know, you've seen right there already two or three lazy passes that were easily picked off or stolen. And that's the kind of thing that Simley has to avoid here, Mike.
And we were talking about the feature and the breakdown ran on Simley and how they got their rise. Before Peper took over, Simley was a struggling team. But Peper just brought a philosophy just to play hard. A former collegiate football player at Augsburg played basketball for a season at UW-Eau Claire. He said, you want to have emotion, but not negative emotion. You just want to play hard. And right now, Simley getting a lesson on playing hard. Richfield, I think, learned their lesson from that December loss. But again, this has become a close matchup in the last couple of years. And what used to be a waltz to victory for Richfield is now one of the most anticipated matchups in the Classic Suburban Conference.
Looks as Boyd Lockett there with a little reach in.
That's your first personal foul. January. That was a nice fake, but no basket. Rebound Kain. Richfield playing full court press. Kain has to bring the ball up, and that's exactly what Richfield wanted.
Yep.
Ford Washington on the steal. January inside to Kaylee Adams, rejected by Brown, cleans it up, and Kyla Adams bumps Kain. That's going to be her third.
Kain doing a good job there, snaring the rebound and drawing contact.
Richfield has been absolutely impeccable in containing Simley's posts of Brown and Kain.
Katie Atkins, the 5'10 sophomore, was just checking the game for Simley.
Brown and Kain, as we mentioned, both averaging double-doubles, and both are still stuck at 4 points right now. DeLau to Brown. Brown can't get the line drive, and drawing the foul is Atkins. Well, Atkins to shoot a pair, gets about 1.9 points per game. Most of Simley's scoring comes from their starters. There aren't too many bench players that stand out, but that doesn't. Tim Peper still speaks highly of the bench players.
I'll tell you, Simley has had kind of a tough time at the charity stripe here tonight, Mike. They haven't made good on some opportunities that they've been given. Get the back end there.
Sarah Swatate's really struggling from the line. Kaylee Adams. Back over to Barnes. Ford Washington, 14-footer, swish. Boyd Lockett finds an open DeLau, but she's too strong on the baseline, Jay. January, with numbers, and scores.
Right through traffic. Very tall traffic, if I may add.
Well, January certainly doesn't lack speed. Remember, she is a two-time state champion hurdler, holds the state record in that category, 14.32 seconds in the 100 meters. Barnes, and one.
Right over Kylie Brown.
All Richfield in the second half.
Bobby Beaver back in. Now look at Bobby Beaver as one of those X factors for this Richfield team, right?
As it needed to be tonight. Barnes doing well for Washington. And a fast break play for Kain. And Simley will need to get their stars involved to work their way out of this deficit. They trail by 19. January.
Little miscommunication there.
That was one of the keys
to
the game.
Few times that's happened tonight for this Richfield team.
Well, and speaking of news, we talked a little bit about around the state news. I imagine you've heard of the big recruit Minnesota got last night.
Yep, yes, I did.
Carly Wagner. after the Minnesota-Michigan game. I wonder if that had some sway. Minnesota had one of the more dominant performances of the season, hitting nearly 60% in an 82-67 win.
Well, that's definitely an exciting exciting pickup for Pam Borton.
Well, Wainer was at that game. I know Pam took high interest in her. DeLau open, and she may have been deflected. January all alone, and she'll shoot free throws. The foul will be charged to Atkins, her second.
You know, the thing about January that makes her so impressive, you not only have to deal with her speed and explosiveness, once she gets under the basket, Mike, she uses her body so well.
As we mentioned in the first half, her older sister is wrapping up her collegiate career as January will be ready to embark on hers. Pamela January, playing at South Dakota, will graduate, and I've been told will likely come back here just because there are so many things to do in South Dakota. January's made all of her free throws, and a little more on Wagner. I mean, that pickup, presuming everything works out, is huge for Borton because she has been questioned for the last few years about her recruiting abilities outside of Rachel Banham. Ford Washington hit for the reach-in. And so to get someone like Wagner, who is projected to be an impact player right away.
Oh, absolutely.
Of course, it's not linear. You know, she could struggle. That we hope she does it. I hope everybody succeeds that gets signed to a college. But much like Kayla Hurt was expected to help Minnesota out, and she's starting to now that she's gotten her knee back in place. Here's another steal by Richfield. January picks it up, finds Beaver, and a traveling violation, so no fast break for Richfield.
The one thing that you're seeing here right now, Mike, you know, from a Simley standpoint, you've got to take care of better care of the basketball. You've got to pass the ball better. You've got to be precise. You've got to be crisp with your passes. They're not doing that tonight, Mike.
Kain working away around Beaver. No. January used up the dribble, finds Hammonds. January scored 26 in the first meeting against Simley, but didn't have much support. Can't get the bounce there. And that's why Simley got the 51-49 win. At the time, Richfield was ranked number one. Boyd Lockett. Good. She does draw the foul. It's on January. That's going to be her third. She's going to stay on the floor. Mackenzie Schramm making her first appearance in the game for the Spartans, and Lindblom going back in.
A little bit of trickery there by Simley. Found Elia open there underneath the basket, and she converted. Caught Richfield sleeping a little bit.
Simley's going to need a lot more, though. They're down by 19. There's your three-point specialist, Pure. Mackenzie Schramm with the first field goal. Kain was trapped there, again, having to bring the ball up, unable to find the guards. And this is where youth may be coming into play. Beaver, no. I certainly wasn't expecting a 22-point margin, but again, you shut down the post.
Yeah,
Simley hasn't found much of an answer outside of Alexis Boyd Lockett. And another reach-in foul on Richfield. They're out of fouls to give now, but again, they have a cushion with 22 points. .906 left in regulation. And they were looking for Kain, but Richfield also sensed that. And here is Adams, but she's too strong, can't finish. Lockett for three. Kine with an offensive rebound, can't draw the foul. She made the right move as a post player. She didn't bring her arms down, which is something a lot of posts often do, but she may have released a little too quickly. Schramm, top of the key. Yes. And another timeout by Simley. Richfield in position to score a runaway win here, 55-30 with 8:28 left.
And Schramm, the unlikely source of doing a lot of damage here in the last few minutes, Mike.
Like we said, January at the beginning of the year stated, I do not want to score 35 points a game. And Scott Statham said, we aren't better when she gets those numbers.
Yep.
Because January does such a good job of making her teammates better. And most of the time, they can rip up opponents that way.
Yeah. And you know, for the Simley team, you know, playing a team like Richfield that's so aggressive, there's only so much you can simulate in practice. That's part of the problem. You know, you have to play games and you have to get experience because, you know, there's only so much you can simulate in practice. This is a good experience here, I think, going down the road for Simley.
A little more on Richfield. We talked about Lindblom. She took a trip to Washington, D.C. We mentioned her grandmother works at General Mills. They're a sponsor of the close-up program. And so Haley Lindblom's application was accepted. So she got to tour the White House, the Saudi Arabia embassy, and also met with Senator Al Franken. And came back today. Said she's a little tired, but not many kids get to go to Washington, D.C. when they're still in high school. And so I'm sure everybody was happy to see her take part in that trip. No, she was excited. Simley can't hit the three-pointer. That was Willard on the attempt. And then earlier this week, the varsity and JV teams teamed up with the boys' team. And I'll hold that thought. They teamed up with the boys' team for a Feed My Starving Children event, which is something a lot of schools take part of. Lockett. A lot of things have not gone well for Simley today. It's just a conglomerate of everything going wrong. You know, three-pointers not falling in, Kain and Brown struggling to score. And this is not a team where you want to have everything go upside down. January with the steal. She sees an opening. Goodbye.
Abby Kain right in her face, too.
Well, January's not intimidated by those taller post players. And foul is called against Kaylee Adams. That's her fourth. Richfield in the penalty, but with a 27-point lead, I don't think they'll have to worry too much about the foul situation. This will send Kine to the line. As we mentioned, averaging a double-double, but for both Kine and Brown, I'm sure they'll be reviewing the game film and making a lot of adjustments here because, again, this could be a potential state tournament matchup. Both teams are in different sections, and we know
somebody being serenaded happy birthday.
Well, I think the Richfield fans are taunting using Abby's name as part of the punchline there. That's what it is. Kind splits. But again, they're in different sections, and we've seen before in teams that have more than one matchup throughout the year. We saw that with Central and South a few years ago, Hopkins, Indian Prairie a couple of years ago. Once you get to the state tournament, your regular season games no longer have any meaning.
Yeah. And you know, the other interesting aspect of it too, Mike, when you look at the sections and you look how the seedings, when they finally are determined, you look at it on paper, you think, well, this is going to happen, and then suddenly there's an upset.
But this, again, may have potential state implications, too, should these two get through. Had Simley been able to pull off a win tonight, that would have given them the advantage, and there's a runner from Alexis Boyd Lockett, the only player in rhythm tonight for Simley.
Nice drive down the middle there by Alexis Boyd Lockett getting the score.
But with Richfield getting a convincing split here, unless something funky happens in the last 6-10, it's going to make the seeding decision a little tougher for the coaches when that state tournament field is selected, should these two teams get there again. Wow, an over the back foul on Richfield. The Spartans fans aren't happy about that, and Simley will shoot more free throws. The foul is on Kyla Adams. That's her fourth.
You know, you look at the Simley roster, dominated mostly by freshmen, or excuse me, by sophomores and juniors, and you can see why the hopes are high at Simley, Mike.
And so even if they don't get through or have this kind of these miscues, again, because they are young, the only senior on the team is Alexis Boyd Lockett.
Yep.
Tim Peper has set this team up for long-term success. He saw the potential of these players. He was a coach on the JV boys team. It will stay with Simley before taking the girls' job. He said, especially last year with that 22-win season they had, it fed to the younger players. Now, a school that's known for wrestling, they've won the last 5 championships in Class 2A. Now you have players looking to play girls basketball. And we talked about, you know, Kain, and we'll talk a little more about these Simley players. Alexis Boyd Lockett, the senior, said her nickname is Koala, and she likes M&Ms. Unfortunately, those two don't go together. You know, there's no koala-flavored M&Ms, but
a lot
you never
of people
know.
Like M&Ms. I like M&Ms.
Well, I was sad when they took out Crispy. I was sad. That was one of the worst days of my life. So, Boyd Lockett, as we mentioned, the quick guard and in rhythm tonight. And the other person, Kylie Brown, we want to mention her, said she didn't start playing post until freshman year, even though she's usually the tallest person on the team she plays for. But as we mentioned, Pepper praised the way Brown can play the guard slot as well. And as we mentioned, we'll probably play three, we'll hang out the 3 and the 4 next year.
Yeah.
And she's sharing a laugh with the officials. So you see the Simley team, I'm sure they're not going to be happy with this loss if it works out that way, but they know there's still a lot of games left. It's the last month of the season, though, so it's all going to be about fine-tuning your game. It's going to be a carrying violation. It's going to be all about fine-tuning your game to set yourself up for section play.
Been a rough night at the OK Corral here for the Simley squad, taking care of the basketball.
Taylor Moore on the dish from January. Can't get the second try. And how about January getting the offensive rebound, and she will anchor the cleanup.
Cleans it up.
24 points for January, and this really isn't all that different from the first meeting with Simley. You know, January matching her point total, getting a little more support, but still the only player in double figures. And yet you look at the score, a completely different storyline than the first game.
Yeah.
We've got a foul on Lindblom. That's her fourth, and more free throws coming for Richfield. And examining the sections again, Richfield will have to deal with Chaska. Chaska number 5 in the Class 3A rankings, and they've had a strong year, which includes a win over, I believe, it was New Richland. Well, that was a close game earlier this season. Simley just not finding their free throws.
Chaska,
get nothing going right.
Chaska, we saw them play at the breakdown.
Benilde St. Margaret's has been hanging around, but not quite as strong as they have been in previous years. Holy Family Catholic has also struggled. And looking at Simley, as we mentioned, St. Paul Como Park got some press. Simley and Como met earlier this season at the Simley tournament. Ford Washington missing the baseline, Jay. And number 10 with the rebound, that's Maria Paulson. January with the steal.
Oh,
and she's patting her. And she pads her numbers.
Shot.
And she matches her point total that she got in the first meeting against Simley.
That's just like practice for her.
What a phenomenal game from January. We said she doesn't like to be selfish, but she knows, we know, seeing on her traveling violation on Kain, that January senses when she has to be the anchor, when she has to be the forerunner.
Yep, exactly. I mean, she'll do whatever she has to do to put her team in position to win, Mike.
Who would have expected
That's just what great players and champions do. They sense those opportunities, those times when they need to step up and take control.
Who would have expected a runaway game? January on the bench. I think we've seen the last of her, but she scored 26. A phenomenal night for her, and she earns some rest tonight. Meeks Johnson called for a traveling violation. Natalie Meeks Johnson on the floor for Richfield, as is Taylor Moore, number 25. Looking more again at these section matchups with Simley, Como Park could be an obstacle. The two met earlier this season. Simley won by 8. But Como Park, they've struggled a little bit against some of the stronger teams. Highland Park, they're done. They got some early love, but with Tamara Curtis I believe it was Curtis transferring, Highland Park has just fallen apart. Hill yep. Murray could sneak back in there. They know how to get there. They've been in the state tournament many times, so they have the advantage of the experience and getting past the proverbial hump, as you mentioned frequently. But again, Simley, at least based on the strength of schedule, would appear to have the easiest road to the state tournament of these two teams. In the game for Simley, also number 25, Kylie Boyer.
I tell you, this Simley team, they definitely do have a lot of height, Mike.
They have a lot of height, and as we mentioned, a lot of room for growth, and we don't mean that negatively. And tonight just didn't go their way, but it's a regular season game, so you can toss this outside. You can toss this in the garbage can, the proverbial garbage can, when this game is over. And Atkins will go to the line for a pair.
Nice job by Atkins getting in there, snaring on offensive rebound, getting fouled, now going to the line.
And before the broadcast wraps up, we have 2:43 left, but I want to get this out there for you Simley fans watching. We mentioned a lot of the players are multi-sport athletes as opposed to the year-round players that you sometimes see with AAU play and whatnot, but they also take part in the PBIS program, which stands for Positive Behavior Intervention System. It's a reward-based system for elementary students and for those that get good grades and stay focused and don't do anything silly. One of the rewards is they get to hang out with the high school kids, and Simley takes part in that program. And the Simley players will talk about the importance of working and behaving.
And, you know, that's really great because, you know, the younger kids, they really look at these players as role models, Mike, and they are.
And that's exactly what Tim Peper said when you paraphrase what he told me in the pregame chat yesterday that I had with him. And he said for the Simley team, it reinforces the value of being role models. Kyle Adams can't hit the three-pointer. Taylor Moore wrestles for the offensive rebound. So it's a symbiotic relationship between these high school kids that you're seeing on the floor, traveling violation on De Lau, and the elementary students that work with these Simley teams. As he said, everything Simley does, those younger kids are watching.
Yep, exactly.
Well, another stat you can throw out the window. We mentioned in the open, Simley had not lost a game by more than 6 points. That's going to change in a big way tonight. But even the championship teams have had their mulligan. Well, we saw what happened to Hopkins. Suffered some injuries, and they caught Centennial on a great night for them with, I think, Paige Wytoszek hitting a lot of threes.
That Centennial team, that's going to be a team to keep your eye on.
And then they got blown out in their next game.
Yeah, I was at them at that when they played at Osseo.
It's all relative, right?
Exactly.
Atkins will shoot another pair. Kennedy going to do some adversity right now. They lost Kanisha Bell to a broken hand, so I'm sure they'd love to get her back before section start. But Hopkins and Kennedy have a similar makeup in that they're deep enough where you can take an injury and still be good. Kennedy ranked number one in the state right now. Hopkins at number two. And the team that everyone, I think maybe the underwhelming, or not underwhelming, but the underwatched team kind of is Eastview.
They're always a team that's out there lurking. Very well coached, very well disciplined. They play smart.
They're number three, but they're under the radar. And Roseville's on a big winning streak, but they're in a big conference in the Suburban East.
And you know, and that's exactly how they like it.
So you've got a couple of sleeper teams right behind them. A lot of folks think it's going to be a Kennedy-Hopkins showdown, channeling the rivalry of the last decade. But this could, that 4A class is looking, it got real interesting, especially after Hopkins lost, because everybody, we joked about the standard, even Tony did.
I was very impressed with that Park team that you saw in the breakdown as well. They could be a
Park of Cottage Grove. They've come back after a rough couple of years. St. Paul Central on the rise again. I don't know if they have the talent to.
Larissa Lurkin of Park, of course, very great player.
And let's not.
Great block by Bobby Beaver.
Let's not ignore the 3A teams here with 101 left. We talked about Richfield and Simley a lot, but when you look at the rankings, we talked about De La Salle. They got their act together. They went through the same growing pains Richfield did earlier this season, where you had your stars, but no one to support the anchor, no one to support the foundation. Both teams have found that now. New Prague, their coach very experienced, among the leaders for all-time victories. Marshall, they were in the state tournament. They've been a regular presence there. Red Wing, they've got Tisha Buck.
Yeah, that Red Wing team, you talk about them. You know, they could be a very huge factor, very good. Tisha Buck.
So there's going to be a lot of unpredictability, I think, more than last year. I mean, the favorites, I'd still agree, although Maranatha right now, number two compared to Montanari and Buell in Class A, and in 2A, you never know with Providence because the way of their style, you can't have a bad shooting night because they, you know, eat up about 24 hours every possession.
Yep.
But last year it was pretty clear who the favorites were, and it worked out that way. There really wasn't any close games outside of the 2A game with Sauk Center and Providence. This year
we're going to have to see how some things play out.
We may actually have some close games. We haven't had that in years. Last year, you knew who won. It was just a formality, and everybody just trying to kill time on Twitter. This year, you might have to actually watch the game for more than a half. And that's not to discredit what the teams did last year, just I think you're seeing a little more parity. Bench players in the game, so we want to get their names in. Simley at number 30, Anna Sheffley, number 22, Jenna Paulson.
Just committed to traveling there, the eighth grader.
Number 24, Sam Oberstar, and Saraswati back in for the Spartans of Simley. And for Richfield, you've got number 13, Olivia House, she's on the floor, and 35, Josephine Roll. We want to make sure we get the names out there for any of you watching, because every one of them has a mother, or at least a guardian. But a dominating win from Richfield, all around. House with a buzzer beater for the exclamation mark. Richfield finishes with a 63-37 win. And the game changer has to be those last 30 seconds in the first half. Simley was in position to stage a comeback. Richfield scores three times, and that just sucked the wind out of Simley's life force.
Yeah, it really did. You know, again, it just came down to bases, you know, taking care of the basketball. You know, Richfield so aggressive with their defense, causing a lot of turnovers, and really that was just the whole essence of Richfield's success tonight, Mike.
Well, Richfield wins. Jessica January, the game's highest scorer with 26 points. Only one player from both teams reached double figures, oddly. And yet Richfield with a dominating win. For Simley, their leading scorer, Alexis Boyd Lockett, with 13.
And, you know, from a Simley standpoint, you know, this game tonight, this is going to sting for a little while. This is going to be in their back of their minds. But when Monday comes around, they're going to have to put this one in the back burner, put it in the back of their mind and go back to work, you know, work on the things that they need to work on and get themselves primed for section play.
Well, we'll try to get a word with a couple of the Richfield players. Once again, Richfield wins 63-37 and extends their winning streak to 11 games. Simley's 12-game winning streak is over. We'll come back. You're watching High School Girls Basketball on TSB Television. Mike Peden here with Jessica January of Richfield. And Jess, you matched your point total from the first meeting against Simley, but a completely different storyline. It was a blowout nobody was expecting, but a lot of that was thanks to your strong defense, you and the rest of the team. Just how did you work your way open?
It was definitely team defense. They have two really big tall posts, and that was a big key that we had to focus on tonight. And we played extremely well, and our defense led us to transitions, and we got easy layups. So
the last 30 seconds of the first half was especially crucial. You forced two turnovers that led to fast break layups and then a buzzer beater from Ford Washington. How big was that psychologically?
It was a boost of confidence. We know that they're a very good team, and making turnovers and getting easy baskets is what we needed. So
you extend your winning streak to 11 games. You end Simley's 12-game winning streak. And so what does this do in terms of getting you in position perhaps for section play and maybe making another run at state? I'm sure you'd like to get back there after all the busloads of kids I heard about the first time around.
Yeah, it's just all confidence and motivation to keep working hard. Performing well against a good team is, you know, always a good thing. So it's just motivation to keep working hard.
The last time we were here, you got blown out by Kennedy. And then since then, it's been all W's. What has changed? As the coach talked about how you kind of got away from your game, now you've been getting back into it, and it seems like you and your teammates are now comfortable with each other.
Yep, it's just team effort, working together and knowing each other's tendencies, and, you know, defense is a lot, playing team defense and just working together. So we're really coming together.
I guess last month of the regular season for you, I'm sure these surreal moments are going to hit you as your high school career comes to a close. But what have you learned this year, and what are some goals of yours, and what have you taken from this last year as you make that transition over to DePaul in impending time?
I'm just really trying to enjoy my senior year. Last year playing with these group of girls, and I'm just looking forward to going to DePaul and, you know, getting better every time I play. So.
And I guess, do you have any thoughts about, you know, your teammate going over to Washington, D.C.? You know, she gets the Homecoming Queen Award, and now she gets to meet Senator Al Franken, among other things. But just your thoughts on Haley, what she's been up to?
She's just a great person overall, and, you know, I think she deserves it. And I don't know, she's just a great person, so.
And speaking of that, how big were your teammates tonight on defense? Because Lindblom was active, Sierra Ford Washington, and everybody was in sync in that full court press of Richfield's tonight.
Yeah, like I said, it was team defense. No one person can stop one person. You know, it takes everyone's effort, and our post did amazingly well on the tall girl, so it was just a whole team thing tonight.
Well, last time we talked to you, we had you greet some folks, and this time I'm just going to let you take the floor, kind of your own soapbox here. If there's anything you'd like to say, whether it's a greeting or anything else, the floor is yours.
Thanks, everyone, for coming out tonight. We had a great amount of fans, and hi, Mom and Dad.
Of course, got to get the greeting to Mom and Dad, right?
Yeah.
Thanks again, Jessica, and good luck, and hopefully we'll see you in state tournament time.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Jessica January of Richfield. Mike Peden here with Richfield senior Sierra Ford Washington, who tried to run out on us, but just like your defense tonight, our radar was a little too on target to evade you, to lose you there. But speaking of, defense was huge for you tonight. Talk about your stance defensively.
Just a low stance, and we practiced on it all through practice, to deny the ball. So that's what we do.
The last 30 seconds of that first half was huge. Simley was in position to kind of psychologically fight their way back. Richfield gets 6 points, including your buzzer beater as time expired. And had you been a foot further back, you could have hit a three-pointer, made it even more special. What happened there?
Just a lucky shot, I guess. Yeah.
I imagine you didn't know where your foot was on the line or anything like that. You were probably just trying to get it off.
Yeah, I was just trying to get it off.
Well, next time, if you get the time, you know, just step back there, you know.
Kind of look down next time, yeah.
Well, three, no, that's okay. Either way, that was a huge momentum swing for Richfield. And talk about, What was the locker room like at halftime? You know, it was 27-20. All of a sudden, it's 33-20, and Richfield just didn't back down in the second.
It was exciting. The adrenaline was insane, so we just wanted to pick up the game speed.
And overall, how was your defense? Because you shut down the posts in Kine and Brown, and you couldn't get their three-pointers. They couldn't get going. Everywhere Simley was, so were you.
Our posts, they did amazing tonight. They shut down the post, and that's what we needed.
11 wins in a row when you end Simley's 12-game winning streak. So how does this establish Richfield as a team to watch for in this 3A field as we get closer to playoff time?
It feels good that we're winning and beating like the good teams.
I'm going to give you a shameless plug here. Of course, one of your good friends, Haley Lindblom, just came back from a trip from Washington, D.C., and not many players get to do that. And so I guess what was the feeling like? You know, she comes back, she does well, but, you know, you go from meeting Senator Al Franken earlier this week to clamping down and neutering Simley's defense.
She did good this game, as usual. That's a comeback, so we're proud of her.
I'm sure you're proud of everybody else because everybody was contributing tonight.
Yeah, we did good as a team.
Well, last month of the regular season, what else does Richfield need to polish up before they take on sections and try to make another state tournament run?
Our good shots and passing the ball. So, yeah.
We got quite a few good shots tonight. Is there anyone you want to say hi to that may be watching this?
Just my parents.
Of course, you got to get the parental plug in, right? Thanks, Sierra, for your time. Congratulations. And who knows, maybe we'll see you in state again.
Thank you.
Sierra Ford Washington of Richfield, that wraps up our coverage from here. Richfield winning 63-37. For everyone here, I'm Mike Peden. Thank you for watching.